Good evening, everyone. This is Mike Barrick with Coach Lorne Henning of the Springfield Indians, and welcome again to Springfield Indians Hockey. Tonight, the Indians take on the rival Southern Division New Haven Nighthawks. And first of all, Coach, tonight, a big game for the Springfield Indians, one of those four-pointers.
Well, anytime you play New Haven, it's a big game, but they're behind us. And last time, we were in the same situation about 3 weeks ago, and we lost the game, so hopefully we can come up tonight. And we were a little undermanned last game. We didn't come up with a great effort, but tonight, if we can win the game, we're sitting in a pretty good position. But if we lose the game, we're right back. We've got to scratch and claw every game. So it's a big game for us. And obviously, it's a big game for them. They've got to start winning, especially when they play the teams that are ahead of them.
On Friday night, the Indians played the Baltimore Skipjacks in a big game for third place, and your team came up late in the third period and came up with a couple of goals to win it.
Well, we didn't really come flying out of the gate. It was kind of a slow-paced game for the first period and a half. We picked it up the last part of the second period and had a couple chances. And then we came on in the third, and it was kind of a close-checking game. They've got a team that likes to check, play close to the vest. And we fortunate Dirk came up. Casey made a bad clearing pass on the power play, and Dirk is an opportunist that he is. He got a big goal for us, and then he came back and got another quick one. So it wasn't a great game, but we'll take the 2 points.
Coach, last week the Springfield Indians and the Sherbrooke Canadians. It was the seventh game in the last 9 days, and the Indians took on the Maine Mariners the next day. Indians came out of that big 8-game, 10-day stretch with 4 victories and 4 defeats. Are you pleased with that final figure, or do you think the Indians could have done better, or what do you think?
Well, that's definitely a tough stretch, and it's originally when we walked into it, he'd like to would have been happy with 4 victories, but as we went along, we won the first 2 games, and we lost a tough one in Rochester, which I thought we could have won, and then we played great in Baltimore, and then we played an outstanding game in St. Catharines. So the way we were looking at the last 2 games, I was hoping to get at least 1 victory out of it, but Saturday night was a tough one. It was probably the flattest we've been all year, but I was afraid of it because we're coming back off the road trip like that. We traveled all night and many games we had, and then Sunday's game, which is in the afternoon game, you got to get up and travel right away. So I guess 4 victories, being realistic, was had to be satisfied with it.
Were you a bit tired after that trip was over, sitting on that bus? Did you enjoy sitting in that bus seat? You had to love that.
Well, the guys were starting to crack up at the end. If we'd have went any more time on a bus, I think they would have went bonkers. But I wouldn't want to do it again. I know we got a long road trip at the end of the year, but it's not quite as bad. We don't have as much travel, a little more plane travel. But hopefully we don't have to go through that again.
Coach, tonight the New Haven Nighthawks, as you were mentioning, the Indians had done pretty well against New Haven, except for the last time these two teams met when New Haven came up with the victory. They're really aiming towards the Indians. They know this is almost a life and death situation, 11 points or 7. So the Indians would love to break it open, I would think.
Well, that they're coming out. They've got, obviously it's a big game for them, as we said earlier, but we did have their number before. We played very well against New Haven. That doesn't mean anything right now. I mean, that was early in the year, and a lot of players have come and gone since then. But they've got a very fast skating team, and they move the puck great. And they've got, on paper, they've got a lot of talent, and they've got some goal scorers. So if you're not hitting, you're not eliminating them. They can be an outstanding team. But if you've got to eliminate them, you got to step in front of them. You can't let them get some momentum going. And that's what we did the last game. They came out, they were charged up, and they took it to us. And they were moving the puck, and we let them move it, but we got to let them play our game, and if we can get some. They haven't had great goaltending in the past, and now Scott coming back has settled that down a bit, and that's helped them a lot. But if you don't have the goaltending, then it's tough to stay competitive, and I know they were struggling for a while, and now with Scott coming back, they've been a lot more improved team, so they're definitely a better team than they were earlier in the year. And so we have to come out, and hopefully we can put something on the board early and take it to them.
Coach, the game Friday night, one player that really impressed me out there, didn't score any points, but was out there defensively, Chris Pryor. He got knocked down with the puck a couple of times, but came back right up.
Well, Chris is an outstanding individual character-wise, and he plays hurt. He's hurting tonight. He's questionable, but he got 2 shots on the foot, and he got a shoulder injury, and he gives it everything he's got every game. He's always the first guy at practice and the first guy at the game. He's there early, and he's just a great competitor, and he doesn't like to lose, and he gives it everything he's got, and he's kind of goes unrecognized a lot of times because he's not flashy. He just does his job, plays his position, moves the puck, and then it's too bad because he's played well for us. He's come on since the start of the year. He's probably been our most improved player.
Well, Coach, tonight the New Haven Nighthawks, big game for you. Good luck tonight.
Thanks, Mike.
That's Coach Lauren Henning of the Springfield Indians, the Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks coming right up. Springfield Indians hockey in just a moment.
Exerscape just for the health of it at the Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Sports Center, your year-round sports facility. You can enjoy ice and roller skating as well as indoor soccer and floor hockey. The Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Center has a full skate and pro shop, so you'll find what you're looking for. From amateurs to experts and anyone in between, a complete snack bar will satisfy that athletic appetite. For birthday parties, club get-togethers, or special occasions, renting a rink is the fun way to throw a party. And it's as easy as the Springfield Olympia Sports Center, conveniently located at exit 13 off I-91.
The Springfield Community Network presents the Springfield Indians against the New Haven Nighthawks. Good evening, everyone. This is Mike Barrick along with John Forstland from the Springfield Civic Center, where the Springfield Indians meet New Haven for the eighth time in 1984-85. And John Forstland, the Indians have done very well against the Hawks. However, the last time these two teams met here at the Springfield Civic Center, New Haven came up with a big 4-3 overtime win.
That's right, Mike, and that game was seen right here on the Springfield Community Network. And of course, it was a long time coming for the New Haven Nighthawks to pick up a victory against Springfield this year, but they did it in overtime, a thriller. Marty Dahlman with the goal, and that was a great game, 4-3. And you know, these clubs are quite familiar with each other this year, meaning, and of course, the geographic proximity between the two clubs is there, so we're quite familiar with New Haven, and the fans are as well, so we're looking forward to a great game here tonight.
On top of that, the big game is increased by the fact that the Hawks are trying to catch the Indians in the Southern Division standings. Currently, the Indians lead New Haven by 9 points, but as they say, a four-pointer in the standings, and the Indians could break open to an 11-point lead with a victory tonight.
Very pivotal weekend for the Springfield Indians here tonight as they try to stretch their lead and their hold on third place, as well as put some distance between themselves and the fifth place club, the New Haven Nighthawks. For those fans who do not know, the top four clubs in the division qualify for the playoffs, and that's the goal of the Springfield Indians. And of course, New Haven is in that fifth spot, as you mentioned, Mike, and they really need this game here tonight. So it's been a big weekend. The Indians coming off a thriller 4-2 victory over the Baltimore Skipjacks, looking tonight for a great effort against the Nighthawks.
The New Haven Nighthawks are going to be featuring a former Springfield Indian in the lineup tonight, Rob Flockhart, who played 14 games with the Indians earlier in the season and picked up 13 points. He'll be in the lineup for the New Haven Nighthawks, but the Springfield Indians have some good players as well that have been playing very well. And on Friday night, Dirk Graham came up with 4 points. He was spectacular in that win over Baltimore.
That's right. A real veteran, Dirk Graham, is going to give that Indian attack the extra punch they need in the offensive part of the game, and Grant provided it with a hat trick on Friday night. So, you know, Mike, when the Indians need to lean on somebody, the veterans have got to be there, and Dirk Graham was on Friday night. But, you know, it's a balanced attack, and it could be a shining star on whatever night it may be.
Well, we're going to take a look at two key performers that are going to be in the action tonight. And first, let's go with New Haven Nighthawks, big scorer, Darrell Evans.
Well, the number on his back reflects the number of goals he scored last year, 51. And I'm speaking, of course, of Darrell Evans. There he is right there on your screen. And Darrell is the leading scorer against the Springfield Indians this year in the season series. He has 2 goals and 7 assists for 9 points. There are his stats on the year. But Darrell Evans, of course, a ninth round pick of the Los Angeles Kings back in 1980, is a goal scorer. And against Springfield this year, he's registered a lot of points and is a player that has to be watched on the ice for New Haven.
Yes, and we know that Darrell Evans was that big hero with the Los Angeles Kings a couple of years back in their upset fifth game victory against the Edmonton Oilers. And the Springfield Indians are paced by the first round, first pick overall by the Minnesota North Stars, Brian Lawton. And ever since he's came down to Springfield on both occasions, he's continued to sparkle and pick up points.
That's right. He's showing everybody why he was the number one draft choice of the Minnesota North Stars back in 1983. In all of hockey, for that matter. And there he is right there at a Mount St. Charles High School in Rhode Island. Brian Lawton has compiled those statistics right there, playing in just a few games for Springfield. So for Brian Lawton, he's really getting a chance with a lot of ice time here in the American Hockey League to show his skills off, and he's doing just that for Springfield.
Well, both teams have made their appearance on the ice, and momentarily, an exciting Southern Division game between the Springfield Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks. And John, I tell you, we've seen New Haven a lot this year, and
I'm sure the fans will enjoy this hockey game.
That's right. They're rivals from way back, and they're rivals again tonight. So sit back and relax and take in this one. Springfield and New Haven, it should be a good one.
Now let's pause for the playing of our national anthem here at the Springfield Civic Center prior to the Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks. Job from Francis Smith. So it's the Springfield Indians and the New Haven Nighthawks. Let's take a look at the Springfield Indians lineup and goaltender Mike Sands. Sands will be the netminder tonight on the season. 20 victories, 10 defeats, and 2 ties. The winningest goaltender in the American Hockey League. And also Mike Sands has only lost 3 times at home this year, going 12 victories, 3 defeats, and 2 ties. On defense for the Indians, Ken Leiter and Chris Pryor. The forward line, Brian Lawton, Tim Tripper, and Mark Hamway. For the New Haven Nighthawks, starting in nets will be Ron Scott. There you see him, 7-11-2, 3.89 goals against average. On defense, Stu Smith and Jim Weimer. The forward line, Jerry Miner, Larry Patey, and Rob Tudor. And we're underway here in Springfield, a key Southern Division game. And here come the Indians. Chris Pryor able to clear one into the Nighthawks zone. Back after it along the near side is penalty killer and defensive specialist Larry Patey. Back for Jim Weimer. Ahead on right wing as the Hawks are able to clear one for center. But the Indians, Mark Hamway breaks that up and gives for Tim Trimper. We're just underway as Trimper feeds for Brian Lawton, who tips into the Nighthawks zone. Scott is able to clear one on right wing. And taking over for New Haven is Andre Dorey. He clears rink wide along the near boards for Jim Weimer, who comes to center and speeds into the Indian zone. Shooting! And it's deflected over the glass and into the crowd by Sands, as Weimer, who's been very good offensively lately, let it go.
Well, we mentioned that the Indians have had some success against the Nighthawks this year, 5 victories in 7 attempts, and of course this is the third time we feature the Nighthawks here on SCN. And Mike, I sat back this afternoon and figured out our record on SCN. It's not too bad, 10 victories and 5 defeats and a tie. So playing here on the Springfield Community Network has brought nothing but good things for Springfield this year, and we're looking for the same result here tonight.
Face off in the Indian zone. We've played 49 seconds into this opening frame, no score. Planned away in the loose puck taken by the Indians, Vern Smith. Here is Smith out of his own zone. Clears to center for John Markle, but tipped off at the New Haven line. Now the Hawks' Chris Cano shoots one and deflected away by Sands. Now behind the net, Sands trying to clear one himself on the near side, and the Indians are able to tip one for center ice, and here comes Handy. Right wing for Alan Kerr, and the whole play whistled out offside at the New Haven line. The referee this evening is Andre Duhamel, the linesman Bill Dobman, and Frank Quigley.
Just underway here at the Springfield Civic Center this week, defenseman Tom Hirsch was called up to the Minnesota North Stars. Hirsch, of course, had starred for Springfield over the past couple of weeks, and his loss will be felt. Tim Kulis is the only player on the injured list for Springfield, suffering from that groin injury, and we'll talk with Tim in between the second and third periods tonight, so we're going to get an update on his condition and how he's doing. He's an important cog in the Springfield lineup, and he's also missed.
Now planned away in Howie Scruton along the near boards for Darrell Evans, who we talked about in the opening of the broadcast. He's trying to clear one out, but the Indians take over. And here's Alan Kerr, jams up with the Nighthawk player, but the Hawks are able to clear one to center. Here is Dave Jensen for the Indians on left wing for Ron Handy, but Stu Smith is able to clear one to center. Now the Indians clear into the Nighthawk zone. Jensen right in on goal, circling behind the net. Centers one, but taken out of the play. Now Kerr trying to center one. Loose in the slot area, and Handy Gets one for Kerr. It's the Indian center for Handy. Right in a goal. Falling. Spun around. Penalty coming up against New Haven as Markle the loose puck. Markle with a delayed penalty coming up. Gives for Kerr. Kerr into the far corner. Dropped for Jensen, but it goes outside the line. And New Haven is able to take control and touch it. And as they do, the penalty is called. The Indians will have a power play chance.
That's right. 17:56 remaining here in the first period. And the Springfield Indians will go on the power play for the first time tonight. In that line of Ron Handy, John Markle, and Alan Kerr has been making things happen. And that time, as Kerr was streaking in on the goaltender, Scott, he was hauled down from behind by Stu Smith. Smith receives 2 minutes for holding. As you take a look at the Indians' power play statistic, there it is, 41 for 208. 19.7 on the power play, and the Indians have been experiencing some difficulty over the course of the past couple of games, and the Indians trying to mend things on the power play tonight. We'll just have to see how it unfolds.
I tell you, the Indians have done well against New Haven on the power play, however, going 33.3%, 7 for 21. So I tell you, if the Indians are looking to break out of their power play, they might be able to do it tonight against the Hawks, who they've done very well against. Now it's loose along the near boards. New Haven able to clear one outside the line. And then the Indians, as they were trapped in offside.
One player, Mike, I think that's going to help the Indians on the power play is Scott Housen. Housen has just come down from the New York Islanders on Friday to play against Baltimore here at the Civic Center. And Housen is a playmaker. He scored on his first shot, four shots in the National Hockey League, registering four goals, a feat not many players get the opportunity to accomplish. But Housen is centering this line now on the power play. He's a player that's definitely going to help Springfield on the man advantage.
Here are the Indians tipping one in, but Weimer back to get it behind his own net. Jim Weimer, a property of the New York Rangers, clears one all the way down, and the Indians have to go back. Minute and 36 seconds left in the Stu Smith holding penalty. Here come the Indians along the near boards. Dirk Graham, who had the hat trick on Friday night, into the New Haven zone. Graham tied up on the play, and Weimer is able to tip one to center. Now Weimer in the neutral zone, speeds in, feeds it through for Miner, but poke checked at the line, and the Indians' Dirk Graham has to circle back. Now Graham feeding it rink wide on the left side for Brian Lawton. Lawton feeding it through as the Indians try and center for Housen, but it goes right through the goal crease. And New Haven is able to break back on left wing. Here's Chris Kontos carrying the mail, dropping it through as the Hawks on their backhand quickly and Sands the stop on Dave Gagne, who is cutting in. Now Sands himself is able to dump one of the boards on right wing. And here's Dirk Graham. Shovels ahead to center ice, and Ron Handy speeds into the Hawk zone. Handy stops to make a play, holds on to that puck, dropping it through for Markle to Handy, but that's deflected away. Now Handy is able to get one to the right point as Graham holds on to that puck. Graham trying to flip it through, but Gagne is able to deflect it away and outside the line. We are scoreless here in this first period. 26 seconds left in the Nighthawk penalty to Stuart Smith as Ron Handy on the far boards is checked on the play, and New Haven's able to dump one all the way down with just 15 seconds left in the penalty. Now the Indians, the penalty is winding down, clear one in, and the Hawks try and get it out of there and do succeed. Smith is back on. The Hawks have killed it off here in this scoreless game. Now the Indians are able to tip one to the Nighthawk line, but New Haven is able to poke one back on left wing. And after it along the near side is the ex-Indian Rob Flockhart. Flockhart taken out of the play. And after it is the Indians player Vern Smith. He couldn't get it out. Held in by the Hawk. Quickly they score! New Haven jumps on top 1-0 as Dan Brennan knocked it down and put it in the bottom right-hand corner. And New Haven leads 1-0.
Well, Dan Brennan's that rookie out of the University of North Dakota that's really shining for the New Haven Nighthawks this year. Brennan registers his 17th goal of the year on that shot that beat Mike Sands to the stick side. Let's see it again right here as the puck is coughed up in the Springfield zone by Smith. There's the steal by Brennan, and then the slap shot really didn't have a lot on it as he had a tough time getting control of it. Didn't get all he wanted to, but nonetheless beat Mike Sands at the 4:26 mark to give the Nighthawks the 1-0 lead.
Should be an unassisted tally by Brennan as the loose puck taken along the near side. Indians try and center one. Here's Terry Tate behind the net, but he's checked on the play. Now Tate winding behind the net, trying to get it for Dale Henry, but the Hawks' Dan Brennan, who just scored that goal, clears one on right wing. Break for New Haven. Rob Tudor into the Springfield zone, but Pryor is able to clear one, but not out. Held in by the Hawks as they wind one for Weimer. Weimer centers in front. Brennan, another shot. Blocked off at the defense. Maybe Sands got a piece of it. Hard to say. Now on left wing, the Indians take over. Lead pass to center for Terry Tate, but
Hayden skated off by Brennan. Now Tronche in after, but he runs into a Nighthawk player. There's Chris Pryor pinching it behind the net for Tronche, but poke check by Weimer, who's able to deflect one along the near side. They end up giving a couple of assists on that last goal. Flockhart and Weimer, and New Haven has the lead 1-0 as Brennan had scored it, his 17th at 4:26. Now to center ice, the Indians' Housen. Ahead for Graham into the Nighthawk zone. It goes on goal and stopped by Scott. Now New Haven is able to get one for Steve Seguin, the youngster in the LA Kings organization. But the Indians, Hodak is able to deflect one into the Hawk zone. Held in by Housen as he moves in. Tries to center for Bodak. Now Housen and Stuart Smith battle along the near boards, but the Hawks recover. They're able to feed for Seguin. Lead pass on left wing for Gagne. Ahead on the right side, but the Indians are able to tip one to center. New Haven leading 1-0. We've played over 6 minutes into this first period as the Hawks drop it back for their own defense. Now Graham in after it, but he couldn't control it. Seguin couldn't get it out. Indians hold it in. Bodak for Housen. Housen overskates the puck, and the Hawks are able to recover and clear one into the center ice area. Now it's shot to the Nighthawk line, and Andre Dorey picks it up. Lead pass to center. Here is Blaise Dell trying to get one through, but blocked off of the defense at the last moment. And then Springfield's able to recover, and Leiter is able to shoot one all the way into the Hawk zone.
Well, the Indians really haven't tested goaltender Ron Scott so far in this game, Mike. Still looking for their first really good scoring chance.
Now the loose puck taken, and Howie Scruton in his own zone. Try to get one out, but Hamway is able to deflect one. Now Tripperl on the far board. Centered for Hamway, but both checked at the Hawk defense, and Patey has it on left wing. Here's Larry Patey. Is able to scoop one into the air and right on goal and handled by Sands. Here is Chris Pryor in his own zone as the Hawks in a forecheck. Indians try and get it out of there. Hawks able to get it to the left point for Scruton. Shooting right on. Sands the stop. Big rebound. Hawks again. Patey in after it, but a hand pass is called right in front of the net.
Well, 12:42 remaining here in the first period. New Haven on top, 1-0. We have tonight's Tribe Trivia ready to go, and we'll be showing it to you momentarily and get a chance once again here on SCN to test your hockey knowledge and see whether or not you can come up with tonight's answer. The next breakage and play, we'll have that question for the fans. It's become quite a popular fixture here on the Indians broadcast, Mike, and it's been shown through the response we've gotten through the mail on our Tribe Trivia. And fans have got to keep sending in those questions because we're going to use them on the air here. We just have to compile enough of them and decide which ones are the best, and we'll use them. We'll have both the question and the address to send questions momentarily.
I tell you, you've taught me a lot about hockey, John. I never get any of the answers correct. I just guess every time that it's going to be Bill Sweeney, and maybe I'll be right one of these days. Now it's cleared on the far boards, but held in by the Indians' Jensen. On the left side for Trimper, he centers one, but nobody there except Larry Patey, who's able to clear one to center. New Haven, who has a one-goal lead at 1-0 in the first period, able to clear one into the Springfield end of the rink, and taking over in his own zone is Chris Pryor. Backhand ones on the boards for Dave Jensen. Ahead for Mark Hamway. Here comes the Indian right winger out of Michigan State. He is able to clear one to the Nighthawk line, but then unable to get it through, and the Hawks are able to clear one to center. And then back in the Indian zone, Ken Leiter takes over. Ahead for Tim Trimper in the neutral zone. He just able to slide one into the Hawks end of the rink. And the goaltender, Scott, who beat the Indians the last time these two teams met, able to get one, and New Haven able to clear one into the center ice area. Now the Indians' Ken Leiter feeding it through rink-wide for Markle. Into the clear for Handy to Kerr. Back to Handy, but checked off of the Hawk defense and cleared outside the line and all the way into the Indians' end of the rink.
This game sort of resembles what we saw on Friday night against Baltimore. Another slow start here in the first period. It took better than two periods for the Indians to get going on Friday night. We'll just have to wait and see how long it's going to take here tonight.
Now the loose puck taken. Indians try and get one, but Kontos leads a three-man rush to center. Feeding it on the right side. Now Kontos moving in, but Vern Smith deflects it away. Then Koudijs takes a stiff check behind the net. Big jam up. Handy in after it for the Tribe. He is able to, unable to get it out. Stoughton tries to center one, and then the loose puck taken by the Indians. The late penalty coming up against New Haven. And as the Hawks come up with the puck, penalty coming up against the New Haven Nighthawks.
Hooking's the call on Blaine Stout, and Stout did not see any action whatsoever the last time the New Haven Nighthawks were here, that 4-3 victory a couple of weeks back. But tonight, Stouten, who is tied, was tied with Brennan for the top scoring on the New Haven club going into tonight's game. Of course, Brennan takes it over with his goal, gets the call here, and we're going to take a look at it right here on the hooking call. As you see, Ron Handy, he'll be the Indians player at the top of your screen that picks up the loose puck, and there's Stoughton from behind as he hauls him down. A clear-cut call and whistled down by Andre Duhamel.
9:07 the time with a penalty, Stoughton for hooking, and the Indians down 1-0 at a power play chance. Here are the Indians taking over, and Scott Howson in the center ice area, feeding it through on left wing, and here comes Dave Jensen. Jensen checked off at the Nighthawk defense, and the Hawks shorthanded are able to speed to center. Here is Gagne across the line, stops and holds onto that puck, dropping it back all the way to his own defense, and New Haven has to go back in their own zone. They're doing an excellent job killing off this penalty. Now New Haven able to clear one to center, but the Indians take over and feed one for Ken Leiter. Leiter feeds for Howson. Howson checked on the play, and then New Haven able to clear one to center. 1-0, New Haven have the lead. Their Indians have the power play, but the Hawks are able to deflect one all the way into the Indian zone. The Indians playing a little bit disorganized here in this first period, as Howson able to move in, but the whole play whistled down offside at the New Haven line.
Mike, the Indians are experiencing an awful lot of problems in the neutral zone getting something started. They can't seem to work the puck into the New Haven end of the ice, and of course that was the case and has been the case over the past few games. Once the Indians have been able to work it in, they do work the puck around well, but those shots on goal have been few and far between. Our trivia, I've been told, is ready, and there it is. What former Indian is number two on the New Haven Nighthawks all-time scoring list? The former Indian who's the number two on the Nighthawks all-time scoring list, and we'll have the answer for you in the third period.
I guess it's not Bill Sweeney.
Well, you can guess Bill Sweeney if you want. You got your own integrity on the line, so venture a guess.
I said, should I guess Bill Sweeney? I guess I won't. Now as play is underway, here are the Hawks moving in. Patey feeding it through. A shot and the stop by Sands as Jerry Miner was set up by Patey. Now the Indians, Hamway into the Hawks zone. Falls and is jammed up into the boards, but the Indians are able to clear one on the near side. Pryor pitches in. Pryor winding it back through behind the net, but the Hawks are able to clear. Indians on a crazy hop, center for Hamway. Hamway backhander right through the goal crease, but Patey is right there, and Patey shorthanded, backhands one to the Indians line. 15 seconds left in the Stoughton penalty, as the Hawks doing an excellent job shorthanded, shoot one into the Springfield zone. Here is Vern Smith, winding on the near side for Mark Hamway. Hamway dipsy doodles to get around the Nighthawk player Flockhart, and the Indians are able to clear to center. Here's Lawton, ahead for Tim Trimper, and across the line for Vern Smith, the Trimper, but Stoughton pokes, checks the Indians player, and is able to clear one on right wing. Hawks in this 1-0 game with New Haven leading. Feed it on right wing, Stoughton shoots right on, Sands the save, and he covers up and pounces on the loose puck as it kind of went off his pads a little bit, but he was able to hold on.
Well, the Indians squander another power play chance. 8:35 remaining, they have yet to score. The Nighthawks on a goal by Dan Brennan lead this one 1-0, and Mike, you know what I'm going to try here tonight during the second period? Is I'm going to provide a hint on the trivia. When I give the question in the second period, we're going to have the second period hint. And
it's a new feature you've just added.
Just added today. It's a brand new, the second period hint. So there will be a hint to this question coming up in the second period. And it might help you out a little bit.
I tell you,
not
you
much.
Give me a lot of hints and I probably won't get that question.
And show you the answer and it won't help you.
Well, considering you just looked it up in the book, you didn't even use the archives today. Now play underway and the loose puck taken in the Indians. Here in this 1-0 game with New Haven leading, clear one in. Scott is able to leave it for his own defense, and Andre Dorey has it for New Haven. Here is Dorey, who was recently sent down by the New York Rangers, shoots one in. Sands is able to make the stop easily, and then Cowdice is able to deflect one, but not out. Stu Smith is shot, and it's deflected wide by Jensen. Now Jensen behind that fights off with a Nighthawk player. Big jam up along the far boards. Flockhart in after it, but the Indians take over, and Dave Jensen has it in his own zone. 1-0, New Haven leading, 7:52 left first period. As Monty Trotsky in the neutral zone. Backhand pass on the left wing side. Harry Tate in after it. Tate is checked on the play. Stuart Smith is able to clear one all the way down. Indians ladder going back to touch it. They rule no icing as Springfield could have played the puck. Now Gagne stealing one for New Haven, dropping it back, quick shot, and it's deflected as it was let go by Dean Kennedy. Now it's center, but Handy has it for Springfield, and Handy is able to scoop a looping shot all the way into the New Haven zone, and the Hawks have to go back after it. New Haven, leading 1-0, are able to tip one for Blaisdell, the player up to center ice and on left wing for Seguin, but checked off at the Indians line. And a lead pass for Alan Kerr. Too far ahead, couldn't catch up to it, but then Handy does. Handy for the Indians, taking over. Centers in front for Markle, but it rolls off his stick. Now Markle on the far boards, gives for Ron Handy. Handy, the Indians' leading scorer, but is checked off by the Hawks. And Seguin leads for Blaisdell. Back to Seguin, but it was blocked off at the defense and the whole play offside at the Indians' line.
Well, Mike, the Nighthawks are coming off a 7-4 loss at home against Rochester on Friday night, and I think they realize the importance of this game for them to keep themselves in the playoff chase. And I know Coach Nick Beverly knows that. And Beverly, in his third year as the coach of the New Haven Nighthawks, has been under a lot of scrutiny lately as to whether or not his job is on the line or not. We do not know, but Nick Beverly has been under a lot of pressure to win in New Haven in his third year, and this is a big pivotal weekend for the Nighthawks.
Nighthawks, as we mentioned earlier, 9 points behind the Indians coming in, and the Indians also have one game in hand on New Haven. Now play at center ice, and here comes Markle for the Indians. Ahead for Alan Kerr. Kerr in the New Haven zone, bumped off along the near side by the Hawks player, Weimer. Now Seguin along the near boards is able to tip one to center, and then Seguin races after it. Seguin leaving it through, but the Hawks have to just drop it back for their own defense. 1-0, New Haven leading on the goal by Dan Brennan. Now the Hawks, Gagne drops it back for their own defense. Now Gagne at center picks up the loose puck, dropping it through for Seguin on the near side. Seguin winds it back behind the net on the far boards. Now for Blaisdell, he runs into Markle on the far side. Big jam up here behind the net is Blaisdell. Hold puck, feet to the left point. Weimer shoots, deflected, and it's a stop. Big rebound. Blaisdell scores! On the rebound, the Hawks have taken a 2-0 lead after Sands made the original stop on Weimer. And then New Haven were able to put in the rebound and have a 2-0 lead.
Well, both Jim Weimer and Blaisdell have seen action with the New York Rangers this year, and they combined for a goal, the second one of the night for New Haven, as Mike Sands makes the original stop. As you see, the puck was deflected on the way through, and then Blaisdell picks up the loose puck and fires home his 15th goal of the year. That's Sands, who is down and out and out of position, and the Nighthawks have a 2-goal lead.
And Blaisdell, who originally was out of the Detroit Red Wings organization, is able to put it into the corner with Sands out of position a little bit. Now play in the Indian one, and it's Jensen is able to clear one on left wing for Housen. Housen leads a rush to center. Housen for the Indians, into the Hawks zone, in on goal, and should have stopped by Scott. Rebound! And it's deflected in front, and the Indians unable to put it home, and New Haven's Tudor shoots the center. Now in the neutral zone, the Indians, Housen shoots to the Nighthawk line, and Stuart Smith back to get it. Here are the Nighthawks clearing the center, but the Indians are able to tip one for Scott Housen, but Patey intercepts in the neutral zone. Leaves it through, and the Hawks, Stuart Smith's one in, as wound off boards. Big jam up on the side. Now it's as the Hawks are able to take control. Here is Miner trying to center one, but right there, and feeds for Housen. Here's Housen in the center ice area. Moving into the Hawks zone, but is wound to play, and now the puck is shot all the way into the New Haven zone. Now it's back after it and cleared on right wing. Here are the Hawks just scooping into the Springfield zone, and Hamway has back. Now Hamway at center. He's able to run into the Hawks zone, and after for the Indians, and taking over his block. Now it's Lou Strimper, the loose. He tries to center one, but Evans is right there, and he's able to clear one to center. Now Cowdice shooting it right back through, but it's deflected on goal, and is able to deflect it for his own defense, and Evans has it on left wing. He pass on right wing as the Hawks break in again. And finally, Lawton is able to deflect it out to center ice. Now Kontos at center, hands it to the Indians player, breaks in, Trimper shoots, and it's deflected, and wide of the goal. Now Hamway after it to forecheck. Hamway along the near boards. Sticks at it with the Hawks player along the near side. Trying to feed it through behind the net for Lawton. Lawton jams up with the Hawks player Kontos. They still jam up. Lawton tries to center one, but New Haven's a fluck all the way into the Springfield zone. Vern Smith going back after it. Ice is called on the play. John, that last scoring play, evidently they've given the goal to Dave Gagne, his sixth of the season from Weimer to Guillen. But we had thought right off, seen on the replay, that it looked like it was Blaisdell that at home.
I think definitely it's Mike Blaisdell. We're just going to have to wait and see whether or not there is a change, and we're going to have to see if what we get the official word.
Faceoff in the circle to the right of the goaltender Scott here in this 2-0 game. No matter what the scoring situation is on that goal, no matter what, the Hawks still have that 2-0 lead. Play back behind the net, New Haven take over, and Rockhart trying to get it out of there. Indians Henry jams in, then Stuart Smith is able to scoop one high up into the air and then all the way into the Springfield zone where Pryor has to go back. Pryor backhanding one on left wing, Indians able to tip one, but Hawks take over. Now the Indians take over once again as Leiter dropping it back for Trotche. Trotche gets it to center, but the Hawks are able to drop one Flockhart to their own defense, and then Brennan is able to dump one into the Springfield zone. Less than 3 minutes to go in this first period. Hawks have a 2-0 lead. As up to center ice comes Fields, Terry Tate. Dale Henry deflects one over the glass and then into the Nighthawks players' bench.
46 remaining first period. New Haven on top, 2-0. Here's that address we were talking about earlier for Tribe Trivia questions. If you have one pertaining to Springfield Indians hockey at home, through your own archives, you can dig it out and give it to us at Springfield Indians, 58 Dwight Street, Springfield, 01103. Tonight, we've gotten some great answers in its own in the near future, but we finally give our first fan question here, a big moment on SC.
It's going to have to be a heck of a question. I'll do all of your great work that you do each week to compile that question. Now it's loose and the Indians take over. Here's Henry back behind the net. Ian Dwight for it, in after Trotche for the, he skated off. Now Henry centered for Tate, but it's deflected at the Hawk defense, and on right wing, Rob Tudor. Ahead on left wing for Dan Brennan. Brennan, the rookie sensation, deflect one in, and the Indians' Jensen takes over. He's checked. Brennan, the loose puck. Centers one, but nobody there, and Scruton has to hustle back after it. Now for New Haven. Clears one, but the Indians' Markle at center. Backhands one for Ron Handy, but the Hawks are able to deflect one to their own defense. Now Steve Seguin for New Haven, dropping it back to their own defense as the Hawks, who lead 2-0, playing a very disciplined first period. As the Indians, Alan Kerr backhands one on left wing for Markle, but checked off for the Hawk defense. Here comes Blaisdell moving in, dropping it through. Hawks shoot, and it's stopped by Sands. Rebound, and Seguin is unable to put one home. Now the Indians, Markle into the New Haven zone, trying to feed it through, and the play is whistled on, made offside, but then Seguin moves into the Springfield end of the ring. Shoot! Sands to save. Big rebound, and it's deflected right there for the Indians. Ellen Kerr, he couldn't get it out. Hawks hold it in. Here's Blaisdell winding it back behind the net, but Koudice has it for the Indians. The rookie out of Sudbury in the Ontario Hockey League. Koudice shoots the center, then they clear it right back in offside at the Indians line.
Well, we're only in the first period, but we could have a big play in this game. That missed shot there by Steve Seguin, if he had picked up that loose puck and fired it into the empty net, the Indians are looking at a 3-goal deficit and a long battle uphill. 2 goals at this point is not insurmountable, and we've seen the Indians come forward, and they can do it again as we're only in the first period. But if that goal had gone in, really, Mike, I think the Indians would be faced with a uphill climb.
Oh, just a minute and 2 seconds left in this first period. On a couple of goals here in this first period, have a 2-0 lead. From the faceoff, Weimer back in his own zone with now less than a minute to go in this first frame. Able to clear one on right wing for Jerry Miner, dropping it back for Jim Weimer. A lead pass on right wing, but the Indians' Bodak drops it back for his own defense, and then Springfield here. Leave for Chris Pryor. Now Pryor up the center right, scooping one into the Hawks zone, and again goes into the Hawks players' bench, and Mario Prue picks up the puck.
Mario Prue out of Providence College, backup goaltender tonight for New Haven. There's your score once again. Prue, property of the New Rangers. And Mike, you discipline, and I think the New Haven Nighthawks are very happy to have the lead right now. They know the importance of this game. Touching and grabbing going on down there on the ice as they check every player out there. If the Indians need to get back, of course, in this game, but should New Haven get the next goal, I think the play would even be more slow, really.
Now Jensen for the Indians, dumps one through. However, the clear one to center. Here's Miner, checked off by Jensen. And then Ken Leiter for Springfield. Leiter, long shot, and the stop made by Scott. Now Weimer back as the fans get on. It's been a long time since the Indians have gotten a decent shot on goal at all. Patey moving in, shooting right on. Sands the stop, and then with a cover up and the loose puck. The Hawks player moving in with just 10 seconds to go in this first period. New Haven leads 2-0.
Well, every second is precious until that final buzzer goes off. Backbreaker can be provided should a club score waning seconds of a period. In that time, Larry Patey with a drive that Mike Sands played the angle on right here. Let's see it. As you see, Patey, the former St. Louis Blue, California Golden Seal, and Granger, as he moves down right here down the left wing, top of the circle with a blast. And there's Mike Sands. He might be small of stature, but really knows how to play those. Took the short side away from Patey and came up with a save.
Yeah, Patey's been a big acquisition for this New Haven Nighthawk team, not only as far as a regular line is concerned, but he's been a big key as far as killing quick concern for the inside to go big faceoff. And Larry Pater, who we just talked about, will take the draw against the Indians. Right winger Durkin. Big faceoff coming up. Last 10 seconds. Rule that Graham was a bit over anxious on, so the Indians, Bob Bodak, will try to win the draw against Patey. And Hawks are able to get the draw. Weaver shoots. Sands covers up the post, is able to deflect one. Held in by Doris. Weak shot to fly the fence. The buzzer sounding the end of the first period. And the New Haven Nighthawks strike for a couple of goals and play a very solid defensive game. And the Hawks have an early lead over Springfield, too.
Well, if Friday was any indication against the Baltimore Skipjacks, the Indians should be in good shape because the Indians got off slow start in that one, a game that really took them two periods to get it started before coming up with a 4-2 victory. And through one period, it almost looks like the same game, the only difference being that club, the opposition, the New Haven Nighthawks, a different side of the ledger with a two-goal right here, and the Indians with a slow start trying to get back into this game as they loop and come out for period number two. The next goal, this hockey game with a two-goal advantage, there's no doubt about it.
If I caught that shots on goal correctly, it was 12-2. The Hawks outshot the Indians in the opening frame. Well, nothing. We'll be back with our between periods activities, including a look at what's happening in the American Hockey League. Maven, the Indians. We'll be back in just a moment.
Basketball was invented on the campus of Springfield College nearly 100 years ago. Today, Springfield College offers a distinctive philosophy that stresses the education of the total person, spirit, mind, and body. Our students make contributions that really count in community services, physical education, rehabilitation, counseling, and health care. Springfield College. We'll prepare you for life.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Barrick with John Forston. We're between periods, and the New Haven Nighthawks have a lead of 2-0. But as we're talking right now, there's some activity going on the ice, and some of those fans are getting their arms ready for the big paper airplane toss.
Well, I'm really surprised you didn't go down, because it's a chance to win a lot of great prizes. What's going on in the ice right now by tossing a paper airplane into a beautiful 1985 Isuzu Impulse. And there it goes, a sea of paper just been thrown onto the ice. And you can see it right there in your screen. Look at this. Looks like a Radon Entebbe or something here as the airplane flying over at the first fan within a 3-minute time limit to land a airplane in the sunroof. Win a TV, jogging suit, and an AM/FM stereo. So
get your paper ready. Let's see you throw one quick.
No, I told you that I was leaving to you. Oh, I had the books from the library on aerodynamics. I was studying all week, but I decided against it here tonight. But there's what a scene right here. You don't see it too often, but our great crew here at the Civic Center definitely has their work cut out for them.
Definitely so, and John, I know that with that great arm I have in softball, as we've talked about a couple of times this year, I'm sure I could have done that.
I'm going to let that one at rest because I haven't seen you in action, but I've heard a few things from various scouts we have around the building here. If you've heard a few things, maybe true, I don't know.
I'm not that good of a hitter, but my arm, not too bad.
Okay.
Although, from what I've heard about you, we'll talk about it. All right, I'm sure you fans are more interested in learning what's happening in the American Hockey League and not about our throwing ability, and let's take a look at what's happening, first of all, in the American Hockey League's Northern Division. There you see the big jam up, the 9 points separating the first place Fredericton Express and the last place Nova Scotia Oilers. And Fredericton this past week was upended by Maine, who had taken first place in the division. Fredericton back on top.
Well, that's right. Fredericton has just hurtled themselves back into first place. The Maine Mariners had overtaken them, but the Express have started to play some good hockey now. But still, Mike, that Northern Division is tightly bunched, an exciting group, and it should go down to the last week of the season.
Yeah, I was talking to Andre Duhamel on Friday night, and he said that Moncton, Nova Scotia, war there, and
down in the basement spot right now, but both teams not far out of a playoff spot. Every time those two teams meet, it's like World War III. They said that there have been a couple of bench-clearing brawls between the two teams, and there is bad blood when Moncton plays Nova Scotia, and those two teams may be battling each other for the final playoff spot in the division.
Well, every time they've met, it's been a mall in the Maritimes between Nova Scotia and Moncton. And you're right, Mike, it could go down to the last week of the season, and for those Maritime clubs, and the fans especially, a lot of excitement up north.
Yeah, last year, if you recall, those two teams met on the final night of the season. Moncton, when they were known as the Alpines, and the Nova Scotia Voyageurs, and Nova Scotia won it on the final game of the season before a sellout crowd at the Halifax Metro Center. Could happen again this year. Taking a look at the Southern Division standings, and there you see the Binghamton Whalers way up top. And John, every week we talk about Binghamton. They have now won 11 of their last 12 games, and if things don't go from bad to worse, they're going to get a couple of more players. Richie Dunn and also Pat Boutette recently sent down.
That's right. The Hartford Whalers seem to be going with a youth movement now, Mike, and they acquired Pat Boutette from Pittsburgh this year, and now looks like they're going to send the veterans down to Binghamton. Nonetheless, Binghamton benefits from all the talent, the overabundance through Washington and Hartford that they do have. And that record is phenomenal right now at this point, 36-13-4, considering the start that Rochester got off to. Binghamton hung in there with Rochester through their winning ways and now have really put together some great victories. And then again, as you look down the standings, the Indians in Baltimore and New Haven, that's a race right there for those final spots. And the division itself, although Hershey has also been winning of late, so the Southern Division in its own right, also exciting.
Shows you how important tonight's game is. If the Indians pick up the victory, 59 points, and the New Haven Nighthawks will remain at 48. Big difference. And then say if New Haven is able to pick up a victory here this evening. Taking a look at the top scorers in the American Hockey League, no really question as far as the two Binghamton players, Gardner and Francis Getty. You see Pierre Rioux in fifth place, and you don't see the entire top 10 scores, but John, in the top 10, three players from the Moncton Golden Flames are in the top 10, and two players from the St. Catharines Saints, Steve Thomas right there, one of them, and five players in the top 10 are in last place teams.
That's right, Mike, and that is ironic. You don't see that too often, but it's probably because those clubs are relying on just certain people every night. It's a team game, and you have to have that balanced scoring attack that we often make note of here on our broadcast, because the Indians do have a balanced scoring attack. But as far as St. Catharines and Moncton are concerned, Moncton is getting a little bit better of it through the play of Joel Otto, Pierre Rioux, Bruce Eakin, players such as that. They are getting the good scoring punch, which has helped them win. On the other hand, St. Catharines, with Thomas really providing most of the scoring ever since they lost Wes Jarvis, St. Catharines has been hurting on the other side of the ledger.
Taking a look at the Indian statistics, and there you see Ron Handy leading the way with 45 points, and Mark Camway, Alan Kerr, and Dirk Graham, and I'll tell you, Kerr has made a big splash since coming right back from the New York Islanders.
That's right, Alan Kerr, 20-year-old rookie, really has a lot of talent, had a stint with the New York Islanders for about a month this year, and since coming down has made his presence felt. But another player there I think that really is going to make his presence felt if he's here for the remaining part of the year is Dirk Graham. He is a natural goal scorer, 70 goals a few years back in the International League, first team All-Star in the Central League last year. A goal scorer around the net, a player with a lot of savvy, that player could find his way to the top before the year's out.
Well, taking a look at the upcoming games for the Springfield Indians, and it doesn't get any easier for the Tri because three big Northern Division games, including two against those first place Fredericton Express, and maybe the Indians might be able to knock off Fredericton next weekend with back-to-back games, considering the fact that Fredericton in the last month and a half has really been struggling, although still in first.
That's right. Three Northern Division games coming up, and then the next week it's Southern Division foes such as Rochester and Binghamton. So the Indians could get a cushion here with a game up in Glens Falls, always fun Wednesday night. And then, of course, back-to-back games with the Fredericton Express. A rarity sometimes in hockey to play a club on back-to-back evenings, but a chance for the Indians to get some points, no doubt about it.
Well, the New Haven Nighthawks have a lead this evening of 2-0 here at the Field Civic Center. A little bit of a longer delay tonight with all of the activity going on the ice. And, John, we're here down to the waning parts of the season, just about a month and a half, a couple of months left in the year. And is it too early to start thinking American Hockey League playoffs or not?
I think so. I think you have to keep it in the back of your mind, but it is still an early part of the year, Mike. Really just getting into February, I think around March 1st, you can realistically start pointing the way towards the playoffs, although they're always in the back of your mind.
I'm sure Coach Lorne Henning, and we know how he is, would not be thinking about playoffs right now. We know that he goes one game at a time. That's the philosophy for the Springfield Indians coach. And if you would mention playoffs to him, I'm sure he wouldn't be that happy. He wants to talk about the games at hand right now and worry, and if the Indians can win those games, then maybe the playoffs.
That's right. It's day by day with Lorne Henning, the task at hand. And tonight it's the New Haven Nighthawks. So you're right, Mike. He takes them one at a time.
The score here, New Haven 2 and the Springfield Indians nothing. We'll continue our between periods activities in just a moment.
Your ordinary living room. Or is it? These friends have not gathered to talk, reminisce, or play Trivial Pursuit. They're bingo players, and they share the hopes of winning cash prizes and merchandise. Yes, these ordinary people are part of Springfield's hottest new television show, Continental Cablevision Bingo. And as extraordinary as that may seem, all three are about to enter another dimension of time and space in the Bingo Zone.
On the night of November 24th, Wally Bimbenek, his wife Vivian, and their friend Mike Harlinski all won valuable prizes playing Continental Cablevision Bingo. The three players were among 10 nightly winners, and all were sitting in the same living room.
Case in point, three neighbors, all gathered for a night of bingo, each piercing the quiet and comfort of their living room with the excitement of winning on Continental Cablevision Bingo. Perhaps you could picture yourself in that living room, and a little bit richer for it, as you enter the Bingo Zone.
Back between periods here, our score, the New Haven Nighthawks 2 and the Springfield Indians nothing. And my guest, a familiar face, we've had him on once before, and bring him back for a curtain call, the general manager of the Springfield Indians, Bruce Landon. Bruce, thanks for coming on. The first question is, let's have your impressions of this game so far. Not just one period, but let's talk about the Springfield Indians over the past couple of weeks.
Well, the past few weeks, John, we've had a tendency to get behind very early in the game, as we did on Friday night against Baltimore. We just don't seem to have the jump when we first come out of the dressing room for the start of the game. We did that again tonight here against New Haven. We've fallen behind 2-0. We're in a bit of a race here, as you all know. Hershey's climbing up, New Haven, Baltimore, all breathing down our necks. And I think it's we have to move with a little more intensity than perhaps what we have in the last few games. I know Coach Lauren Henning is having a few choice words right now between periods with the troops, because it's unlike this team not to come out with a little fire in their eyes. And I think that's what's been happening the last few games. I think we have to pick up the offense a little bit. We only had, I think, 2 shots on goal in that first period, and that's not enough shots to win hockey games with.
I know you're a firm believer of setting a good impression, especially when you're at home. When you're in your own building, you should come out with that intensity. We talked about it earlier in the year when the club was having some problems, and it's sort of like the Indians right now. If they get into this type of style of play, it's going to really hurt them in the long run. So you're trying to say is that a change of scheme of things is in line.
Well, I think what happens with the Springfield Indians every once in a while, it's not something that's consistent right from all season long, but every once in a while, everybody looks for somebody else to do something to pick the team up. And I know as a former player, you know, it's up to an individual to say, hey, I got to do something to pick this team up, to get the guys going. And sometimes it'll take a good body check. Sometimes it'll take a fight. A couple of times this season against Sherbrooke and again against Baltimore, it took a little scrap just to get the guys involved. And we have some guys that Timmy Trimper and Dirk Graham and Alan Kerr who will rise to the occasion, and they'll do something to sort of perk the guys up. And I think we're missing that. We didn't have it in the first period. New Haven, for the first time in several games that we've played them this season, took the body more so than we did. New Haven usually plays a very, I want to say, dull style of hockey. They just sort of come in, try to lull you to sleep, and walk away with 2 points. And if we play with any kind of aggressiveness and wear them down a little bit, they're going to know they're in a game, and they're going to get some guys that are really not going to give it their all. But we have to come out here in the second period. We can't get behind another goal. We can't keep counting on these miracle finishes that we've been able to pull out so often this season by rallying for 3 or 4 goals. We have to go out first shift, second shift, third shift, right on through the second period, and establish the fact that we are on our home ice.
Bruce, we've gone through the halfway point now and starting to head down the stretch. By no means is the season over, but it is getting close. Let's look back at this year in retrospect and how you think. I know this year has really been difficult as far as player personnel changes, and from a general manager's standpoint, you've seen it firsthand. Let's go back in Bruce Landon's eyes and take a look at this season so far.
Well, we started off the season way back in October with high expectations because of the two parent clubs we were working with. Very familiar with the Islanders, the depth they had in the organizations. Also Minnesota, the depth they had in the organization, especially on defense. And we thought it would be a good marriage because of the two parent clubs that we're working with, wherever the Islanders' weakness was in their minor league system, Minnesota would pick up the slack there. And that really proved to be the case. I think what happened when we first started off back in October, the beginning of the season, is we had two clubs coming together, new coach, new players, nobody knowing one another. It took guys a while to get to know each other, as not only as players on the ice, but as players off the ice and as people. And I think it helps so much to have that harmony in the dressing room, guys being familiar with one another, and that carries over into a game. And I think once we established that, and I think once Lauren Henning had a chance to work with the guys and got some line combinations working together, that you could see it coming game by game. We went through a very tough time through the Maritimes. We didn't win any games. I think we were 1-7-1 at one time, and the fans were getting a little frustrated. The players were working hard. The work ethic's always been there, but it took until we got in the later part of October before you could really see the team starting to gel. And as you know, we hit that tremendous stretch there where we were just, nobody could beat us. We were the talk of the American Hockey League because we had guys like Roger Corco and Alan Kerr. Some of the guys that were not only rookies, but their first and second year in the league were starting to play the type of hockey that everybody expected of them. And we've continued to play that way. We've had a tremendous number of changes in our roster this season, but only because of one thing, because of injuries both to Minnesota and to New York. We're very pleased with our working agreement with both clubs. Neither of the organizations are keeping players in their cities and just sitting them in the stands. They're taking our players only when they have to, and they're giving them a chance to showcase their talent, which I feel is so important here because our players will know that they're being watched. If they do something, they're going to be rewarded. We started the new year talking January 185, and we put a few wins together, but not really with the consistency we had in December. And the club is still starting to play again, I think, the type of hockey it has to play. We're keeping our goals against down, which are very important. We're not scoring the goals by the bunches that we were earlier, but I think maybe because we're worrying so much about our defensive aspects, we're not creating the same opportunities. But I think this team is going to be right there come the end of the season. We got too much talent, a great coach, good character on the team going down the last stretch, the last couple months of the season. And I think that's the character combined with the talent and the coaching. Lauren Henning is going to pull this team into a solid playoff position, and who knows what will happen in the playoffs.
This year, of course, I think one of the things that's really been a big portion of hockey, NHL, AHL level, has been injuries. I've talked to Eddie Tartarski about it this year, and he really didn't think that it had to do with training camp being too short, or really couldn't put a handle on it himself. This year, as far as the injuries are concerned, I'm sure that you've been around hockey for a long time, and what maybe if you could compare the difference between the way the game is played today and when you played, I don't know if there's any glaring differences, but why is this year seem to be the injury year as far as hockey goes?
Well, there seems to be, everybody has their own theory on why there's more injuries this season. I have my own. I think there's a combination of two things. One, I hate to disagree with our trainer, who's a super guy and a great trainer. I think training camp, they rush the guys a little bit too much. They haven't come into camp. They're in camp one day, and bingo, they're in the exhibition swing, playing 8 games in 10 nights, when the guys are in shape because they work out in the summer, but they're not in game hockey shape. And there's a big difference. Using different muscles when you're working weights and when you're running and doing the things in the off season as compared to you do when you get into training camp. And I think the rigorous training schedule combined into a short period of time has a wear and tear on the body, which eventually catches up to some of the players. The other factor, I think, John, is the thing that I think is hurting a lot of players. They're spending too much time in the weight room. I've always been a believer that if you go out and you work hard on practice, you work hard in the games, you really don't have to do too much else to keep yourself primed, ready to play the game. One thing to ride the bike, maybe do a little light exercise, but we have too many players now, which it's nice to see the dedication, but too many players, as soon as practice is over, they rest for a few minutes, next thing you know, they're pumping the weights, and then they may have a bite to eat, next thing you know, they're going to Nautilus, they're playing racquetball, and as we all know, the muscles, the human body only takes so much. It's also, I think, some of the training techniques of the players when they're working out on their own. I know a problem in Chicago developed with players were putting on weight vests and trying to do certain exercises, and as a result, you get the stomach muscle pulls and sort of the strange type of injuries. Gary Green has his own theory, of course, the analyst on USA Color. He says that he feels that the players are bigger and stronger and they skate faster, and that's why you're getting more injuries. That could be a number of different things, but I think the general managers in the National Hockey League have to take a long look at perhaps what they're trying to accomplish in the exhibition season. I don't think it's doing any bit of good if they're playing 8 games in 10 nights, but then they're starting the regular season and they're having 2 or 3 of their guys out with injuries that happen because of a short training camp.
Throughout your career, you've been a part of some championship teams on the AHL level with the Springfield Kings, WHA, the New England Whalers. There's a certain type of, I don't know how to put it, a character that makes up a championship team. If you could relate that type of feeling that you experienced as a player to being around this club, do you think any of those characteristics are prevalent, and how do you see the finish?
Well, there's no question that I think talent alone doesn't win it. You have to have the players with the heart the size of a football. They have to have character. They have to have dedication to the game, both on and off the ice. And I think we see that here in Springfield. We saw it back when I first won our first Calder Cup when I played in Springfield in 70-71. We had some guys that were veterans that had a lot of character, wanted to win. We had some young kids like Butch Goring came to play every night, and they were cocky and confident. And boy, nobody was going to let them take it away from them. And I see that on guys like Timmy Trimper and Dirk and Alan Kerr and our defenseman Vern Smith come along strong. These guys all come, Dale Henry, they come to play every night. And they want to win. They don't want anyone stealing anything away from them. If a team's going to beat the Springfield Indians, usually they have to beat them because they're just maybe up. It's their night to win. Maybe Springfield's let down, combination of things. But I see a lot of comparisons between, similarities between the teams that I was on back in World Hockey Days in 72 when we won the championship. Guys like Teddy Green, who had been around with the Boston Bruins, had so much heart and soul, meant so much to our winning that championship. Compared to the team we have here, we have the guys with the character and we have the guys with the talent. And I think if you put it all together and the guys stay healthy over the final few months, Springfield has a legitimate shot of putting the Calder Cup banner up here.
Well, if the banner is raised to the Civic Center rafters, it will go back to this tape and it'll all be on your shoulders, that's for sure. Bruce, thanks for coming on with us. Always a pleasure to talk with you. Let's hope that great things happen down the stretch here in 85.
Well, I'm looking forward to it, John. It's going to be an exciting finish.
Sure is, and we'll have it all for you right here on the Springfield Community Network. Back with more second period action right after these messages.
Skate just for the health of it at the Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Sports Center, your year-round sports facility. You can enjoy ice and roller skating as well as indoor soccer and floor hockey. The Springfield Olympia Ice and Roller Center has a full skate and pro shop, so you'll find what you're looking for. From amateurs to experts and anyone in between, a complete snack bar will satisfy that athletic appetite. For birthday parties, club get-togethers, or special occasions, renting a rink is the fun way to throw a party. And it's as easy as the Springfield Olympia Sports Center, conveniently located at exit 13 off I-91.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Barrick with John Forslund, Springfield Civic Center. New Haven leading by the score of 2-0. Now loose into the Springfield end of the rink and taking over is Chris Pryor in his own zone. Pryor ahead for Brian Lawton, sticks one to center, and Andre Dorey scoops one all the way back in. Here's Pryor in his own zone, circling to make a play. Up ahead for Graham, ahead for Brian Lawton. Lawton scoops one into the Nighthawks zone. Hustling and after, Dirk Graham. Graham stops to make a play, trying to get it back on the near side, and then New Haven's able to dump one up the center ice. We've played 35 seconds into the second period. Hawks leading by a score of 2-0 as Graham in his own zone. Circling to make a play. He's able to deflect one or just kind of dump one to center, and the Hawks tutor scoops one right back. Here's Leiter in his own zone. Bumped up by Connells, moving in, but Tripper is able to break that out. Now Tripper unable to get it out as the Hawks here early in this second period doing the bulk of the controlling as taking over, and the right point is Smith shoots and deflected way up high over the glass into the crowd.
Well, just underway here in the second period, 18:53 remaining, and if you're just joining us, the Nighthawks have a 2-0 lead thanks to goals by Dan Brennan and Dave Gagne, and that has given them the lead at this point. The Indians have two games coming up this weekend at the Springfield Civic Center, both against the Fredericton Express, and you won't want to miss the Express, the Northern Division leaders, as they square off against the Indians this weekend, Friday and Saturday night at 7:30, right here at the Springfield Civic Center.
Now it's cleared all the way into the Springfield, into the New Haven zone, and Big Howie Scruton has it along the near boards. Dropping it, gives it up ahead on left wing. It's the Hawks. Seguin, a long shot and stopped by Sands. Now it's jammed up behind the net. The loose puck taken by Handy. Ahead to center ice, and here comes Housen. Housen in across the line, trying to drop one through. Now Housen centers one, but Stuart Smith breaks it up. Now Lawton upended. The referee, Andre Duhamel, watches impassively, and then a hand pass from one Indians player to another. Actually, on that last rush up left wing, it was Darrell Evans who had let it go. Sands had made the stop. 18:23 left second. 3-0 New Haven.
February 20th will be card night here at the Springfield Civic Center. Card Collector's Closet in downtown Springfield, who control the novelty works. The Indians have come up with a card set.
base bubblegum card set with the Springfield Indians pitchers on it. And if you come to that Wednesday night game during school vacation, you can pick up a free card and also a voucher good for a dollar discount on the entire set. That's February 20th, card night here at the Civic Center when the Indians face off against the Baltimore Skipjacks.
Now Jensen moving in, shooting and deflected at the defense, and it's cleared out the center. Now Vern Smith ahead for Scott Howson. Howson shovels ahead on right wing, but the whole play whistled down offside. The passes are just failing to click.
Well, they really are. Flat's the word. We talked with general manager Bruce Landon in between the first and second periods, and he mentioned the fact that the Indians are getting off to those slow starts, and they have been able to come back from those slow starts, but I asked him if he felt that it could catch up to the club in the long run, and he felt that it did, and he felt that the Indians would come out with a lot of fire here in the second period. We're just going to have to wait and see. We're still early here in the second frame.
Now play along the near side, and Dahlman is able to deflect one into the Springfield zone. And taking over, Dave Jensen. Dahlman out of RPI University, checking with Jensen, but Jensen moving in. Jensen trying to work around the defense, but Weimer sticks him into the corner. Now it's jammed up in the near side. Howson trying to get after it. New Haven able to clear the center. Fans a little bit on the Indians at this point. It's handy at center. Skated off by the Hawks, and they clear one into the Springfield zone, and Sands leaves it for zone defense. Here's Jensen along the near side. Ahead for Handy on left wing. Handy up ahead for Howson. Howson moving in. Howson for the dive. Shooting, and the stop by Scott, and he's able to get on top of it as it was deflected through.
Well, not much on the shot, but a weird deflection. Almost got goaltender Ron Scott as Scott Howson took the drive. Let's see it right here on SCN where we have all the angles covered. Here's Scott Howson with the puck right here. And watch the bottom of your screen, number 16, Ron Handy, as he heads for the net. He's an Indians player who does get a stick on it right here. There it is. Actually, it was the glove hand that stuck out and knocked the puck down, changed directions. But Scott, with that great concentration, came up with the stop. 17:23 remaining here in the second period. The Nighthawks with a 2-0 lead.
Now the faceoff controlled Indians. Kaudai shoots, and it's deflected high and wide as Kaudai still looking for his first professional point. Now Pryor at the right point. He shoots, deflected. Owen Scott makes the save. Big jam up along the near boards. Tate in after it, but Blaisdell is able to come back to center. Now Blaisdell ahead on left wing. Hawks shoot. Score! Steve Seguin with a blast. And New Haven leading 3-0.
Well, we said that the next goal of this hockey game was very important, and it could be a turning point. This goal, the third by Seguin, who took the drive right here for New Haven. His eighth goal of the year that Mike Sands really didn't have a chance on. It was a bullet. Let's see it again. Mike Blaisdell with the puck coming in on Jim Cowdice. As he cuts to the center of the ice, he gives it to Seguin on the left wing, who lets a drive go from the top of the circle, glove side, high on Sands to beat him and give the Nighthawks that big three-goal lead.
Now Seguin centers one, but blocked off the defense. Now behind the net, Seguin in after it, but Tate has it for the Indians. And up ahead on right wing, Hamway shooting, Scott a glove save, and he pounces on the loose puck and makes the save, and we'll have a faceoff in the New Haven zone. The score by Steve Seguin, the youngster out of Cornwall, Ontario, played for Peterborough last year of the Ontario Hockey League, a third round Los Angeles Kings draft choice back in 1982. They look for a lot of good things for him. His eighth from Blaisdell and Smith at 2:59.
Well, the Indians are going to have to dig down right now, Mike, and come from behind. A three-goal deficit, tough to come back from. The Indians are up against it here tonight. 16:39 left to go in the second period. Plenty of time, but they have to get it going soon.
Now, play taken by the Indians, and Ryder is able to deflect one behind the net. Now, the Indians, Graham, trying to get one through on the far side, but New Haven takes over at center, and they just scoop one all the way into the Springfield end of the ring. 16:19, left second period, New Haven leading 3-0, and Scruton at the point, winding a third, but Vern Smith is right there. Winds it on right wing for Graham. He couldn't get it out. Hawks clear it right back behind the net. Indians try and clear one on right wing. Graham is checked on the play, and he's able to shovel ahead for Lawton. Here's Lawton along the far boards, taken out of the play by Miner, and Leiter has it along the near boards. New Haven leading by three at 3-0. As Leiter comes to center, long shot wide, bounces off the backboard. Scruton able to deflect it, but held in by Vern Smith. His weak shot broken up at the Hawks defense, and up the center ice come New Haven. Here is a long shot wide. Hawks try and center one, but the loose puck taken by the Indians, and Vern Smith takes over. He is unable to get it out. Dory holds it in. Dory is tied up by Lawton, And the puck going again in the Nighthawks players' bench.
Well, with a three-goal lead, if you ever thought you're going to see deliberate style of play, you're going to see it now from the New Haven Nighthawks. They do like that style. They have gotten the advantage right now, and they can sit back and really put their minds to defensive hockey. I believe that's what you're going to see right now. The Indians are going to just have to get a break and catch a hold of one and capitalize on it. And if they do, get themselves on the board, and that might get the wheel started right here for Springfield. But it's a long climb back. We'll have to see what happens.
Play into the Springfield zone, and Dave Jensen controls for the Tribe. Ahead on right wing and up the center ice for Housen. Housen backhanding one for Handy. Handy under the far side, but Kerr is right there. Kerr is centered for Housen. He's checked. Now Handy trying to get it through, but New Haven able to break it up, but held in by Kerr. Kerr feeds for Handy. Handy right in, but Dory steers him aside. Loose puck taken. Indians take over. Housen trying to center one, but the Hawks are able to deflect one to center. Now Housen for the Tribe. Spinning back into the New Haven zone. Housen feeding it through for Kerr. Shoots, scores! Alan Kerr gives the fans something to cheer about and cuts the New Haven lead with 3-1.
Well, there it is right there, Alan Kerr. And it couldn't have come at a better time as you take a look at some of the joyous crowd here at the Springfield Civic Center. Kerr's 25th goal of the year after he took a beautiful pass from Scott Housen. Here's Housen, who's been up with the New York Islanders just coming down on Friday. He feeds Kerr, lets a slap shot go from about 20 feet, beats Ron Scott, and with 14:50 to go here in the second period, the Indians have cut the New Haven lead to 3-1.
And then assist for Scott Housen gives him now an 8-game scoring streak. He had 14 points in his last 7 coming in. Now has an 8-game streak. Here is Trotje for Markle on the far boards. Markle for the Indians. Deflects one behind the net for Trotje. Trotje for the Tribe skated off. Big jam up behind the net. Indian Bodak in after it. Jams up with a Hawks player. It's scored. Now Bodak behind the net. Checked off. Now Bodak against the Hawks player behind the goal, Rob Flockhart. Now Indians try and center one. Here's Miroslav Molly. Molly back behind the net for Bodak. But New Haven able to clear and on left wing come to center. Here's Dan Brennan for New Haven. Ahead for the player Dolman. Dolman skated off and turned aside by Vern Smith. And then Miroslav Molly, the Czechoslovakian import, takes over behind his own net. Feeds it on left wing ahead for Bodak. Bodak is able to just dump one into the Hawks end of the rink, and New Haven take over. They try and clear it out and do succeed outside the line. 13:48 left second period, 3-1. The Hawks have the lead over the Indians. But the Indians, John Markle, long shot wide, bounces off the backboards, and the goaltender Scott almost put it in himself. Now it's cleared over the glass and into the crowd on the near side.
Well, 13:33 remaining here in the second period. Don't forget that trivia question tonight is, what former Indian is number 2 on the New Haven Nighthawks all-time scoring list? What former Indian is number 2 on the New Haven Nighthawks all-time scoring list? And the second period hint is, he was a member of the 1974-75 Calder Cup championship team here in Springfield. There's a hint. Any guesses from you? Great Houdini. Any guesses?
Wouldn't it really shock you if I got the answer right away, and that would take it away for the third period, wouldn't it?
I know that's impossible, so I'm not worried.
Playing away along the far side. John is just bursting with confidence as the Indians are able to hold one in. They feed for Henry. Henry is checked on the play, and New Haven able to clear out the center ice. Now Leiter ahead for Dale Henry. On left wing is the Indian speed in. Tamway ahead for Tate, but broken up with the Hawks defense and able to clear to center, and the Hawks break free. Here's Blaisdell. Lead pass on the left side. Sagin shoots. Save, rebound, score! The Hawks lead 4-1 after Sands made the original save, and it looks like Gagne on the rebound poked it home, and it's 4-1 Hawks.
Well, this could be a big goal in this hockey game. If we look back at this one in retrospect, Dave Gagne, empty net after Mike Sands had come up with the stop, gives the Nighthawks a 4-1 lead. And this line of Blaisdell, Dean, and Gagne has been flying all night long for New Haven. Here's Blaisdell on the left side for Sagin. On the bottom of your screen, there's Dave Gagne streaking in. And a little bit of a problem there, but here it is from ice level as Mike Sands makes the save. It glances off his skate, and there's Gagne unchecked as he picks up the rebound and fires it into the top corner to give the Nighthawks a 4-1 lead.
Now if that goal in that first period was credited to Gagne, that would be his second of the night. Now back behind the Indians net, Dave Jensen. Drive ahead for Brian Lawton on right wing for Dirk Graham. Graham into the New Haven zone. Graham around Dory, tries to center one, but Blaisdell breaks it up. Now Lawton speeds in. On the right side for Trimper, back to Vern Smith. Smith winding it back behind the net for Brian Lawton. Lawton tries to sidestep a check, runs into Andre Dory. Dory and Lawton fight for the loose puck at center, but nobody there. And right to a Nighthawks player. Here's Larry Patey shooting into the Springfield end of the rink. And Sands leaves it for Vern Smith. Here it checked on the play as the Hawks into forecheck. Tudor. But Trimper is there, and Graham on the right side for Trimper, and he's able to clear one all the way into the Nighthawks zone. Scott sets it up for zone defense. The Hawks, who had lost a couple of games in a row prior to tonight, look pretty good this evening as Miner breaks in, but Vern Smith deflects that away. Now alongside Patey, a backhand pass, but going right to Handy, or to Graham, ahead for Trimper. Trimper on left wing, across the line, but it's offside.
Well, my Nighthawks have been experiencing their problems. As you mentioned, on Wednesday night, they dropped a 6-1 defeat at home to Baltimore. Friday night, a 7-4 defeat at home, once again, to Rochester. Couple of games right there where they've had some problems keeping the opponents off the scoreboard. That's not the case here tonight, as you can tell. They come out with a different style, defensive-minded, and they've gotten the goal-scoring punch. Four goals almost halfway through the game, yet only one for Springfield, so it's a defensive-minded approach for New Haven.
Now at center ice, the Indians take over, and here comes Scott Housen into the Nighthawk zone. Housen stops to make a play, holds on, centers one in front for Kerr, backhander, and a stick save by Scott. Big save by the Nighthawks goaltender. Now Molly at the left point, shooting, and the stop by Scott as Molly let a blast go. Now Handy behind the net, centers one, but Stoughton is right there and leads the rush to center. Stoughton into the Springfield zone, centers one through and right through the goal crease. Now to the left side, Scruton holding on, winds back behind the net for Stoughton. Stoughton, the former 50 goal scorer, centers, they score again. Chris Contos, as he was set up beautifully by Stoughton, and the Hawks have broken in top by a score of 5-1.
Well, with 11:01 remaining here in the second period, the New Haven Nighthawks are beginning to pull away with this one. The fifth goal of the game for them. Blaine Stoughton, the former NHL sniper, 56 goals 1 year with the Hartford Whalers, and he has it behind the net right here. He's playing on a line with Darrell Evans, and this man right here, Chris Contos, big draft pick for the New York Rangers, and he fires home the goal for New Haven, his 12th, and the Nighthawks lead it by four.
Well, the Indians, who had won in a very good game on Friday night, here this evening trouble, so here midway through this hockey game, 5-1 trailing. Now on right wing, Indians Trotche at center. Ahead for Bob Bodak, but New Haven able to dump one to center. Now Springfield able to move in. Here's Bodak in the clear, but the whole play offside at the Nighthawk line. And John Markle not happy with that call as he gives some lip to Bill Dobman. The scoring play, Contos his 12th, Stout an assist, as well as Howie Scruton at 8:59. And the Nighthawks, after the Indians had made it 3-1, have scored two quick unanswered goals to make it a two-goal quick one and make it a 5-1 lead.
And what's been happening is the Nighthawks have been able to freewheel right in front of Mike Sands, not being picked up by the defense, and that's led to a couple of breakdowns, and the end result has been a couple of New Haven goals.
Now the loose puck taken at center, and Leiter into the Hawk zone. Leiter moving in, shoots, stick saved by Scott, and it's deflected over the glass and into the crowd. And John, when you're down 5-1, at this point, is there anything really you can do to change things or do anything different?
Well, you can't try to get the goals in bunches, Mike. You have to take them one at a time, just like you take game by game, as we talked about with Lauren Henning's approach to each game. And I think that's what the Indians have to do now. Try to get each goal as they come. Not try too hard, because what could happen then is New Haven could get a couple of breaks and the game could get too wide open and they really lose control of the game. There's plenty of time left, 10:17 to go in the second period. So inch by inch, they might climb back into this game.
Now New Haven on left wing, into the Springfield zone. Jerry Miner, and he's checked off. Good check by Jensen. Probably the hardest hit for the Indians all night long. Now Blaisdell trying to center one. They jam up with Hamway. He is able to feed for Seguin. Back behind the net for Blaisdell in front, but Hamway is right there and leads a two-man rush to center. Hamway with Tate. The pass to Tate in the clear. Shoots, and Scott the save, and Harry Tate, who possesses a very hard shot, but Scott made the stop.
Well, for a forward, Terry Tate doesn't get the opportunity to use that slap shot too much, but a missed chance, he really let it fly. And here it is again. Tate coming down the wing, and here he is. He led the Indians in scoring for the first portion of the season, along with Bob Bodak. And here's the winger out of Thunder Bay, Ontario, with the blast. He can shoot it with the best of them. Ron Scott has done a fair job in goal tonight for New Haven. I'd say pretty fair. He's only allowed one goal at this point.
He's played pretty good against the Indians this year as well. He's only faced the Tribe two times, but 1-1 against Springfield in 1984-85. Ryan Lawton take the draw for the Indians, gets it back to Vern Smith, shooting deflected, and a stick saved by Scott. Now Trimperl on the near boards, takes over. Tim Trimper for the Indians is tied up. Now it's centered in front for Brian Lawton. Lawton is checked. Now Lawton trying to feed it through for Trimper, but the Hawks are able to break one up, but the Indians hold on. Here's Graham shoveling it through, but broken up the Hawks' defense and shot to center. Now Vern Smith in the neutral zone. Scoops it right back. Scott leaves it for Stuart Smith behind his own net. Winds it on the boards. Pryor tries to pinch in, but the puck goes outside the line. Now Tim Trimper into the New Haven zone. Trimper winding it through. Trimper stops, drops for Vern Smith. Shoots! Scott a glove save, and he holds on as Vern Smith let it go from the point.
Well, what Ron Scott is doing is really controlling those rebounds. He's got excellent footwork, and he's been kicking those shots into the corner. And then when he has to glove them, he ties them up. As we'll see right here, the shot by Vern Smith from the point. Watch number 24, Dirk Graham, as he heads for the net. And then at the tail end of this shot right here, Graham was ready to pounce on a rebound, untouched if there was one. As you see, he missed the deflection, but there's Graham standing all alone, and should have Scott just miscued on that one. I'm sure Graham, who's a goal scorer, would have picked up a goal there for Springfield. Lauren Henning now juggling up the lines a little bit, trying to find different combinations that can work. Not much has worked so far here tonight. As you take a look at your score, it's 5-1 New Haven.
Well, the New York Islander line, you could say, out there. The Kerr, Hulson, and Handy line is right from the faceoff. Handy shot deflected over the glass into the crowd. All three of these players have seen action up with the Islanders this year.
That's right, and as I mentioned before, Scott Hausen, four goals in his first four shots in the National Hockey League. Alan Kerr scored two goals in his first game for New York, and Ron Handy did a steady job also. So as you mentioned, Mike, all three with some NHL experience, and for their young careers, valued NHL experience.
Face off in the New Haven zone with the Hawks up by four goals. Here's Jensen at the point. Moving in. Wrist shot deflected just wide. Good play by Jensen as he kept his shot low, and then we're going to have a penalty against New Haven here, I believe. A tripping call coming up against the Hawks.
Well, the Indians right now will get a chance, and they're not going to get too many of them here, and they're going to have to take advantage. Down by four with 8:47 remaining in the second period. Dean Kennedy gets a tripping call, and the Indians will have the man advantage. Let's see it again right here and see if we can pick out where the penalty is. Steve Jensen with the puck. Watch Kennedy. He's on defense right there as he hauls down Alan Kerr. Kennedy thought that Kerr might have taken a little bit of a dive on that play. Nonetheless, Duhamel calls tripping, and the Indians have that man advantage, which if they can get a goal here, it's definitely a step in the right direction. As I mentioned, plenty of time left. Inch by inch, they have to climb back.
This is, as you mentioned, big power play chance here from the faceoff. Jensen for the Tribe to Graham. Shoots wide. Rebound Handy. Centers one, but it's broken up. Held in by Jensen. Jensen checked on the play, and the Hawks are shorthanded, and here comes New Haven's Patey. Patey into the Springfield zone, but backhanding one in, and Graham has it. Here's Graham for the Springfield Indians. Circling back is Patey, a penalty killer extraordinaire, trying to forecheck and does a good job and gives for Miner before the Indians' Housen recovers. Dropping it back for Jensen. Here's the player out of the University of Minnesota shooting one in. Scott is right there, leaves it for zone defense. Indians try and hold one in. Jensen is able to. Gives for Housen along the near side. Housen, or rather Kerr. Kerr feeds for Jensen. Jensen at the side of the net for the Indians player along the near side. Now Handy for Kerr. Kerr check, but gives to Handy. Centering one, but Miner is right there. Now Jensen a poke at it, but blocked the defense. And then Andre Dorey feeds one and backhands one over the glass and into the crowd. And the Indians don't seem to really be getting a number of opportunities in the offensive zone.
Well, they work the puck around quite well, and they like to do that. Lauren Henning employs that rotation style on the power play, New York Islander style that they like to employ, and the Indians do pass the puck quite well, but sometimes they have some problems getting shots on goal, and it'll come. You know, the players are all trying their best out there, and they're a little tentative when they get the puck. They want to make that perfect pass that's going to result in a goal. Sometimes, though, if they can take a shot on goal, it might be a better chance.
Now play to the right side. At the point, Vern Smith to Ken Leiter moving in. Shooting right on. And the stop by Scott in New Haven. Clear one all the way down. And the Indians have to go back. 7:34, left second period. Hawks leading 5-1. Another 44 seconds left in the New Haven Kennedy tripping penalty. Now Vern Smith for the Indians. Coming to center, slapping one in. Into the far side, Tripper, the loose puck. Here is Tripper for the Indians. Trying to wheel and spin. Getting it through in the far side for Vern Smith, the Tripper. Tripper holds on to that puck. Looking, feeds for Smith, shoots, and it's deflected wide. Now Ken Leiter feeding it through. And New Haven blocks it, held in by Hamway. Hamway feeds rink wide for Vern Smith, but it hops over his stick. Now he spins one on the far side for the Indians, Lawton. Lawton is tied up, but then circles along the near side. Here's Brian Lawton behind the net for Hamway to Lawton. Player Kennedy is back on. Indians Leiter at the point. Backhanding one through. Into the far corner for Tripper. Tripper is checked on the play. Stuart Smith couldn't get it out. Hamway holds it in. Centers one, but right there is New Haven's Kennedy. And then Stuart Smith is able to clear the zone as the Hawks have killed it off, and they lead by four and make a good play as they are able to kill off this penalty. Now New Haven cutting in again on the far side. Hawks try and dump one in front for Stoughton, but checked away. Now Sands clearing one on the far side for Bodak and dropping it back in his own zone and taking over his lot. Lead pass on left wing for Vern Smith, but knocked back into the Springfield zone as Stoughton moving in. Hitting it through on the near side for Miner. Miner spinning to make a play, but Lawton is right there as Leiter was right with him. Now, Hawks Miner feeding it through. Quick shot off the side of the net. Now Springfield takes over, and finally Bob Bodak for the Indians leads a rush to center. Here's Bodak into the Hawks zone, trying to get through, but Hawks take over, and Weimer in his own zone is able to clear one, but held in by Springfield's Bodak. Bodak, wrist shot, and it's deflected wide. Markle in after it, he falls on the play. Bodak back behind the net for Trache. Trache battles with Miner, and Miner beats him to it and feeds for Darrell Evans on left wing. Number 51, Evans into the Springfield zone. Wrist shot deflected by Sands over the glass and into the crowd, and things don't look too bright at this point.
They really don't. A bleak picture painted here tonight on SCN. 5:18 remaining here in the second period. And the Indians on the downside, 5-1, and really haven't gotten much started all night long, Mike. It's an uphill battle, as I mentioned, and the Indians now are faced with it. Big 2 points here to pick up on the New Haven Nighthawks, but the Nighthawks realize what kind of game it is for them, and they've put together a good effort here tonight. Probably a bigger game as far as their scheme of things goes for the playoff position. They don't want to fade out of the picture, that's for sure. And tonight they've come out like they want this game, and it's shown so far.
Well, we hope you're enjoying the action on SCN. Maybe not the score is what you would have liked, but hope you're sitting back and enjoying the hockey game nonetheless. Now it's played in offside out the Springfield line, and we'll have another faceoff. Down the crowd here this evening, pretty quiet tonight, not really much to cheer about.
Really isn't, Mike. Tough one for the fans. The Indians have been averaging 35-55 so far this year and have been getting some good crowds recently. And tonight is another good crowd on a Saturday night as you take a look at some of them. But there's not much to cheer about when the home team's down by 4 goals.
And if things don't get better, they're going to be yelling at us, John, and we don't want to see that. Now it's loose, it's centered, loose in front. Scott the save as a quick backhander in front. Now Pryor for the Tribe, able to deflect one. Big jam up in the far boards in New Haven on left wing. Dahlman into the Springfield zone, but Molly beats him to it, and Terry Tate has it along the far boards. Ahead for Dale Henry. Henry beat for Trache into the New Haven zone. Trache with Dale Henry. Trache behind the net. Scooted off by Scruton at center. Pryor shoots off the side of the net as Pryor had a chance. Dale Henry also went after it, but Scruton is able to clear it on the boards. Molly knocks it back down. Hawks trying to clear it out. Indians hold it in. Here's Henry trying to feed it for Molly. Now Henry checked on the play, and New Haven able to clear to center. 4:18, left second period. New Haven leading 5-1. As it's center, the Indians take over, and Ron Handy has it for the Tribe. Handy for Springfield. Moving in. Handy, but tied up on the play, and then Blaisdell dropping it back for zone defense. Now Dory hands it at the point for New Haven. Beats at the side of the net, in the far side. Now it's quickly deflected and stands the stop. Seguin has it. into the near corner, checked off on the play. Flockhart also battling in there, a couple of Indians as well. Andy feeds for Jensen, stolen away by New Haven, and Flockhart clears it right back behind the net. Now Kerr on the far side for Housen, and he tips the center. 3.5 minutes to go as Kerr jams up with the Nighthawk player at center, knocks him down, and then that player on the far side wants to get it out on Kerr. Here with 3:26 left in the second period. Kerr's not afraid to give his weight around, throw it around a little bit.
No, he really isn't. And Stu Smith and Alan Kerr get the sticks up along the far side. Frustration setting in now for the Springfield Indians, down by 4 goals with 3:26 remaining here in the second period. You look at Stu Smith, the former property of the Hartford Whalers, played in Binghamton for a couple of years and now toils on defense for New Haven. But the Indians right now getting frustrated. Really haven't put together a great effort here tonight. And I think now the tempers are going to get a little bit short as we head down towards the end of the second period and into the third.
Now the Indians, who came into the action this evening with a very, very good record on home ice, 16-8-2. But really, this is one of the few times all season long that the Indians have been down by this much midway through the hockey game. Now it's jammed through in front, but Leiter is able to steer one aside and then has it in his own zone and feeds on right wing for Alan Kerr. Here's Kerr for the Indians, ahead for Housen. On the side for Handy to Kerr, shoots, and Scott, a skate save and the rebound taken by New Haven. Up to center ice come the Hawks. Pass on the near boards for the player Gagne. Now New Haven, Sakine, checked on the play. Big jam up on the near boards. Now Stuart Smith at the right point. Shoots right on. Sands a stop rebound and deflected away. Kerr for the Indians. Ahead for Housen. Housen leads a rush to center. On left wing for Handy. That's too far ahead. And the Hawks are able to clear one all the way down into the Indians end of the rink. Hustling back after it, Vern Smith. And icing is called, which is 2:29 left in this second period. 5-1 New Haven, and John, don't fall asleep.
No, I won't, Mike. I have you here to keep me awake with the voice echoing through the headsets. How can anybody fall asleep?
I knew you were falling asleep for some reason.
No. 2:29 remaining here, and the Indians, of course, don't want to keep the fans from falling asleep as they try to pick things up here throughout this game. They've had their troubles getting going here tonight, and that's been the case, and we've stated it over and over again tonight. And that man right there, Lauren Henning, coach of the Indians, I'm sure not happy with the performance of the club through two periods.
And there you see Nick Beverly, the coach of the New Haven Nighthawks and former player of New Haven. Now back in the Indian zone is Chris Pryor. Ahead for Dirk Graham. Graham clears one into the Nighthawks zone. Back after for the Hawks is Stoughton. He couldn't get out. Molly, a drive and blocked the defense. And then New Haven comes to center. Here is the player Weimer getting one through, but broken up. Now Miner takes over, but Graham breaks that up. And Graham feeds a pass on left wing for Tripper. Tripper ahead for Brian Lawton in the far corner, but Patey is right there. Now the Indians, Lawton takes over. Trying to feed it for Graham to the right side for Pryor. Winds back behind the net for Tripper. Tripper at the side of the net for Graham. Graham is too closely checked, and Patey doing an excellent job defensively, able to clear to center. Less than 2 minutes to go in the second period, a minute 37 to be exact, 5-1. The Hawks have the lead as Jim Weimer back in his own zone. Weimer, who scored 4 goals as the defenseman last week for New Haven, clears to center, and then the Indians tip to the Nighthawk line, and then New Haven feeds it right back in. Minute 20 left in the period as Pryor feeds ahead for Graham on right wing, on left wing rather, for Henry, and the play offside, which is a minute 16 seconds left, second period. 5-1 Hawks.
Well, the Nighthawks really had that luxury of keeping a man back, and 3 men at the blue line that time created that offside, and the Nighthawks can do that up by 4 goals here in the second period as you take a look at floor director Lisa Charpentier with the arms up.
And there's mine.
There it is. I just give it the little wave there. And
call that a wave?
Yeah, whatever it is. The Nighthawks, defensive style, Mike, with a man back, and really at this point right now can hang on with a big lead.
If that's a wave, I tell you, that looked more like a...
It's a gesture. It's not a wave. It's a gesture.
That's more like it. Now play in the center ice area with less than a minute to go in this second period. It's cleared to the Hawk line and then shot all the way in. Chris Kontos races after, but Sands is able to stick one on the near side for Dale Henry. And Henry has it for Springfield. Ahead for Terry Tate into the Nighthawk zone. Tate trying to get one through, but deflected behind the net. Scott trying to clear it out. Held in by Vern Smith. Smith for the Indians. Shooting and deflected. High up into the air. Scott bats at it. Now it's cleared behind the net. Evans slaps at it, but Vern Smith holds it in. Here's Smith for the Tribe. Nifty move with 27 seconds to go in the period. Circles behind the goal. Checked on the play. Tries to center one. Scott is able to deflect it, and then Nighthawks couldn't get it out. Indians hold it in. Vern Smith cuts in. Shoots. Scott the save. It's a good chance for Vern Smith. Indians hold it in again as the Indians pressing here in this last 10 seconds. But the Hawks recover and take over and are able to dump one to center. 2 seconds to go. Jensen takes over and the buzzer sounds, signaling the end of the second period. And the Indians almost strike to make it 5-2, but Scott made a key save and keeps it 5-1 New Haven.
Well, it would have been a big goal should the Indians have scored. And right now the New Haven Nighthawks in total control, really, of this game through two periods. 5-1, not much you can say for the Springfield Indians' effort through two, but there's 20 minutes of hockey left and it's never over. They're cliches that are often used. We'll just have to see if they come true.
Well, the story here, as we mentioned, 5-1 New Haven. We'll be back with our between periods activities, including an interview with Indians injured winger Tim Coolis. The score 5-1 in favor of New Haven. We'll be back in just a moment.
Basketball was invented on the campus of Springfield College nearly 100 years ago. Today, Springfield College offers a distinctive philosophy that stresses the education of the total person, spirit, mind, and body. Our students make contributions that really count in community services, physical education, rehabilitation, counseling, and health care. Springfield College, we'll prepare you for life.
Welcome back, everyone. Mike Barrick with John Forsen here at the Springfield Civic Center. And John, it's been a tough night for the Springfield Indian fans and the team itself, trailing 5-1.
Well, Mike, it's hard to find words to describe this one thus far, really. 5-1 on the downside for the Springfield Indians. Two periods of really flat hockey is all you can say for Springfield. There's 20 minutes left, and they really can come out now for 20 solid minutes and see if they can inch their way back and take it a goal at a time. We'll have to see how it unfolds. Let's look at the highlights and see how they've gotten to this point so far.
Okay, let's go right to the highlights as we see New Haven jump on top 1-0. And Dan Brennan, the rookie, was able to put one home for New Haven.
Well, Dan Brennan picks up his 17th goal of the year right here on a shot that really fooled Mike Sands. He thought that it might have been a little harder than it was. Brennan had a tough time controlling it and then slid it in past the stick side of Mike Sands, gave the Nighthawks the early 1-0 lead.
Then the Hawks would take a 2-0 lead. They had originally said that Dave Gagne got the goal, but we're positive. You are positive and I'm positive, although it wasn't announced as such, that Mike Blaisdell made it 2-0, and that's the way it was at the end of one period of play with the Hawks leading, and the Indians only got two shots on goal in that opening frame.
That's right, and we don't have that goal for you, but they did credit the goal to Gagne, and it looked like Blaisdell from our standpoint up here. We'll try to see if we can have that for you at the end of the game. Nonetheless, Gagne got the goal, and that gave the Nighthawks a two-goal lead.
Then in the second period, the big back-breaking period, at least so far for the Springfield Indians, the Nighthawks coming up with three goals and had a 3-0 lead after this one.
Well, it's been one line for New Haven tonight that's done a great job, and that's the line of Dave Gagne, Mike Blaisdell, and Steve Seguin. And here's great combination work right here by the Nighthawks as they break into the Springfield zone. Blaisdell right here slides the puck to Seguin, and Seguin moves in, and he really lets a blast go from the top of the circle that Mike Sands did not really have a chance on, as it was in the net before he knew it. But it was a big goal right there. The third goal, when there's a two-goal advantage, is oftentimes pivotal. Whether it had been for Springfield or New Haven, Springfield would only have been down by a goal should they have scored the third goal. New Haven got it, and it gave them an important three-goal lead.
Then the Indians would come back to make it 3-1, and Alan Kerr would net the goal. And for a little bit, at least, it looked like the Indians would come to life after this one.
Well, this looked like the spark the Indians needed at this point. Alan Kerr, the rookie, comes in right here, and he picks up a beautiful pass from Scotty Housen. Housen feeds him as he threads the needle right there and sets up Alan Kerr, lets a blast go that Ron Scott never even saw. And for Kerr, he picked up his 25th goal of the year, and the Indians looked like they were coming back into this game.
However, things didn't turn out that way, as the Hawks were able to score a couple of unanswered goals to make it a 5-1 game. Here's the fourth one that really shook things up a little bit and gave New Haven the momentum once again.
Well, Kerr's goal came at the 2:59 mark, and then it was rather at the 5:10 mark, and then it was at the 7:08 mark that this goal was scored by Gagne, as he was set up beautifully from Mike Blaisdell and Seguin. As we see it right here from ice level, Seguin with the shot, it glances off the skate of Mike Sands. He's out of position right there, and Dave Gagne is unchecked, and he came through to pick up the loose puck, knocking into the top corner, and it gave the Nighthawks command at 4-1.
And then Chris Kontos, the player out of the New York Rangers organization, would put one home to make it 5-1.
Well, Kontos right here takes a pass from Blaine Stoughton, who is stationed behind the net, and just slides a harmless shot that through the pads of Mike Sands to give the Nighthawks the 5-1 lead where it stands right now. Here's Kontos cruising through the slot area, picks up the puck. He also had a tough time getting control of it, but he got enough of control to get his 12th goal of the year and give the Nighthawks the lead, which we have right now at 5-1.
Well, it looks like I had just heard that from Peter Cooney back there that they might recruit you and put you on the ice in the third period, and I'd be up here all by myself.
Oh, well, if that ever happens, I'm sure we'd go off the air and maybe the franchise would fold. I don't know. We don't want to get to that point.
You're a pretty good skater, I understand.
Yeah, pretty good.
John, on the Christmas, big Christmas skate, you wouldn't even get on the ice. What happened?
Bum wheel. I had a bad leg. I couldn't come out for that.
Had a bad leg all season, from what I understand.
It's an old war injury.
Yeah, that's what I've heard. Well, don't buy that. He will not go out onto the ice and... you're more of a baseball, softball player, from what I understand.
You're on a roll tonight. You know that.
Well, you know, you've been on one all season long. I figured I might get you back a little bit tonight.
Great. That's great.
Is that all?
That's it.
All right. He's going to let me go at that. Well, the score here, the New Haven Nighthawks 5, the Springfield Indians 1. Tim Kulis, who is on hand here, will be John's guest in just a moment. 5-1 New Haven. We'll be back in just a moment.
Your ordinary living room. Or is it? These friends have not gathered to talk, reminisce, or play Trivial Pursuit. They're bingo players, and they share the hopes of winning cash prizes and merchandise. Yes, these ordinary people are part of Springfield's hottest new television show, Continental Cablevision Bingo. And as extraordinary as that may seem, all three are about to enter another dimension of time and space in... the Bingo Zone.
On the night of November 24th, Wally Bimbenek, his wife Vivian, and their friend Mike Harlinski all won valuable prizes playing Continental Cablevision Bingo. The three players were among 10 nightly winners, and all were sitting in the same living room.
Case in point, three neighbors, all gathered for a night of bingo, each piercing the quiet and comfort of their living room with the excitement of winning on Continental Cablevision Bingo. Perhaps you could picture yourself in that living room, and a little bit richer for it, as you enter the Bingo Zone.